This is our 46th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. We have been exposed to different thoughts, different ways of viewing things, different interpretations. Today we have yet another wonderful speaker who was a former Acting Chief Justice of the High Court of Kerala, Justice P.K. Abdul Rahim sir. He will be dealing with a wonderful subject which may evoke lot of thoughts, controversies, and lot of inputs from all the participants. That is Justice Dispensation Confronting Conflicts. We have today Justice Ramkumar sir, Justice Chidambaram sir, and Justice M.S.R. Murthy sir, and all those wonderful persons who have been with our journey throughout. Sir, directly over to you.
Thank you, Shyam Patman. Good afternoon to one and all. Joining this webinar online. And first of all, I may express my deep felt gratitude to Advocate Shyam Patman and his associates for being invited me to lead on this interactive session. The subject, Justice Dispensation Confronting Conflicts. This is a subject chosen on a mutual understanding between me and Advocate Shyam Patman. Because when Shyam Patman invited me, or rather told me that you should participate in one day as a speaker in this series of webinar, I frankly told him that I am not supposed to be an academician capable of handling a particular legal subject because I feel that my temperament is not that of an academician. So I suggested to Advocate Shyam Patman that let us have a general subtopic on which we can interact. All of us can join and interact. So probably you may feel that the topic allotted dispensation confronting conflicts is a very wide subject and it covers a lot of aspects. So I may confess that I may not be able to touch upon each and every aspect of this topic, but broadly what I can do is I can speak about the normal and general conflicts which will come across in the judicial dispensation system. What are the conflicts confronting in the process of dispensation of justice? The conflicts are innumerable, as I said. I may make an attempt to classify them broadly under few captions. One is conflicts arising in the relation out of the relationship between the bar and the bench. Second one is conflicts arising within judicial officers themselves. I mean between their individual personality and their judicial or official position. Thirdly, conflicts relating to upkeeping of morals, values, and etiquettes to be followed in the system, which may eventually conflict with the discipline, decorum, and integrity of the dispensation system itself. Fourthly, one of the main aspects is the attitude, or we may say relationship, of the lawyers community in enabling the process of dispensation of justice in a smooth, noble, and majestic manner. And lastly, how the role of ministerial support in the process should be ensured in the courts where justice is dispensed. So I think I may slightly elaborate on each of the captions, taking into the different aspects coming under each such captioned subheadings. First of all, the conflict is that mainly the conflicts arising in the relationship between the bar and the bench. While dealing with this issue, we have to reappraise or reevaluate how the relationship should be maintained. To what extent the role of lawyers become integral in the process of dispensation of justice. It is always said that the bar and the bench are the two facets of the same coin. It is also always said that only a good bar can create good judges. Another proverb or another phraseology which is normally used is that the only if the bar keeps the quality, the output in the process of dispensation of justice can attain quality. All these phrases in the legal parlance, which is very often used, is having its own importance. From time immemorial, it is said that the lawyers are officers of the court. How far this usage reflects its real meaning, intention, and how far it is useful in promoting the process of dispensation of justice in a cordial manner and in a manner befitting the better functioning of the system. In that respect, the first thing is, as I said, whether the participation of lawyers' community in the process is integral or necessary, or whether it is absolute essential. I may go to the circumstances present in the circumstances prevailing in the present scenario, especially in the subordinate courts. I may be excused if I may say that this awareness among the judicial officers that the lawyers community or the participation of lawyers is an integral part in the process of dispensation of justice, or it is an absolute necessary or essential part in that process, is slowly getting deviated or rather deteriorated. I may say that the practice of recruiting judicial officers who doesn't have a practical experience in courts or who doesn't have much practical experience as a practicing lawyer is creating some sort of difficulties in this area, I may say. The Supreme Court, the Honorable Supreme Court, through its judgment held that the necessity for having practice at least for 3 years can be dispensed with, while recruiting judicial officers in the lowest strata of the system, that is in the municipal magistrate cadre. And nowadays we know the standard of selection on the basis of the academic merit has increased tremendously. In most of the recent selections, in some of the selections, fortunately, I could also was a party in the process of interview and all. There, what I feel is that academically or in the matter of knowledge on legal subjects, the candidates are much better or in a highly merited candidates are coming. Those candidates keep good knowledge about legal subjects. They are capable of analyzing legal aspects. They are capable of probably arriving at a just or right or proper conclusion with respect to any legal issue which may confront in the process of dispensation of justice. Further, the training system which is now being followed, it is 1 year compulsory or mandatory training after the selection is being given to the officers who are selected. And the judicial academies in most of the states are giving great contributions in molding them as good officers, especially with respect to the subject of a procedural law, how to tackle with a different type of cases, what are the procedures to be followed, what are the methodology to be adopted. All these factors are given very good training, and the selected candidates within the period of 1 year is getting more and more equipped with the knowledge of handling the court procedure. But still, I may say that the feeling that the participation of lawyers is integral or essential for the proper dispensation of justice, such a feeling cannot be imbibed by most of the candidates because of their lack of a practical experience as a practicing lawyer. This is giving some sort of confusion as to what extent the role of a lawyer in conducting a case is required or essential in deciding the issues involved or in dispensing justice from the courtroom. In one occasion, one of the senior district judges, when I interacted about this subject in a casual talk, sarcastically told me that some of the junior officers who are newly recruited is keeping a feeling that once the pleadings are placed before them, or once the evidence is adduced before them, they are able to analyze the legal questions involved, legal issues involved, and to arrive at a appropriate and apposite conclusion regarding those issues. And they are capable of rendering good judgment in matters of those legal issues. So with this attitude, what they feel is the lawyers are a community who are attempting to intrude in the process of dispensation of justice in an unnecessary manner. At least in few subordinate officers, such a feeling is being nurtured or inculcated, knowingly or unknowingly. This is a matter of serious concern, because such an attitude is giving way for a lot of conflicts, confrontation in the process of dispensation of justice. Quite often there arises disputes, personal conflicts, and quite often that gives rise to complaints being raised against judicial officers. All these are happening nowadays, and I may be pardoned if I may say that among the subordinate officers, this tendency is in an increasing rate. In this respect, to a certain extent, I may say that how to accommodate a lawyer in the conduct of cases and how to utilize him, utilize his service, and how to control him. These are certain, I may say, it is some sort of an art which has to be imbibed and inculcated in judicial officers. It is not by way of keeping them away from the process or keeping them aloof in the matter of conduct of the cases that this should be achieved. Instead, it should be a harmonious accommodation which has to be provided to the lawyers in the matter of conduct of cases. In that respect, how to behave with the lawyers while hearing a case or while recording evidence in a case is of very, very important. Sometimes, some of the judicial officers feel that the lawyers are taking away very valuable judicial time by unnecessary arguments, lengthy arguments, or unnecessary examination, lengthy examination of witnesses, etc. How to control? I may say that there are lawyers, or there are instances in courts where unnecessary prolongation of the process of litigation and unnecessary time-consuming arguments and unnecessary time-consuming examination of witnesses happens quite often. But how to control it? What should be the methodology? What should be the approach in controlling such an attitude? It is of very important. Without creating a hostility in the lawyer community, or creating a hostile feeling among the lawyers, this can be achieved in a better manner. It was once spoken to by a famous judge that there are two categories of judicial officers. One category, he said, that category includes the judicial officers who dismisses or denies favorable orders in a single day in three or four cases of a particular lawyer himself. The lawyer may not be having any personal ill feeling towards the judicial officer. Another category is there where even if you grant favorable orders or favorable judgments, in 10 cases, in one day, in favor of a particular lawyer, even then, that lawyer will not acknowledge that to the court with any pleasant attitude, or the lawyer will not appreciate a gesture of courtesy or a gratitude towards the court. These two categories, among these two categories, we should equip the system, or we should mold the officers how to become persons in the first category, where the lawyers appearing before a judicial officer should not have an ill feeling, a hatred, or a hostility personally against the judicial officer. This is one of the subject, or rather, as I earlier said, some sort of art which need to be inculcated among the judicial officers, so that a cordial atmosphere and a better utilization of the contributions from the lawyer community can be availed for a better dispensation of justice. In that respect, I may say that the judicial officer, from his behavior, should command respect, courtesy, discipline, and decorum from the lawyer. There may be instances where, if the judicial officer behaves with utmost decency, utmost cordial relationship, even then there may be some lawyers, few exemptions, who advances cantankerous arguments, who behave with the court in an indecent manner, discourteous manner, or in a manner not feasible with keeping of the decorum of the court. Such instances may be there, but by and large, a judicial officer should command respect from the lawyers, and by commanding such respect, the lawyers should be made to behave in a courteous manner, in a respectful manner, keeping the decorum of the court, etc. This is one of the aspects among the conflicts which we often come across in the process of dispensation of justice. Another aspect, at least in some occasions, comes. There may be cases of high public importance. There may be cases of publicity value involved cases. There may be cases concerned with persons who are very prominent in the society. We call them as VIPs. There may be cases belonging to VIPs. There may be sensational cases. There may be cases the society is watching with more enthusiasm. And at least in some occasion, while dealing with such cases, there exists a conflict in the judicial, in the mind of the judicial officers, that if I take a decision in a particular manner, how that will be responded by the public, how that will be responded by other lawyers, how that will be responded by the media, like these aspects also. So, it is always said that justice should be done, and justice should be made, should be done in a manner which should create an impression that it is done properly. So this is an aspect which has to be kept in mind with more caution while dealing with sensational cases in which prominent persons are involved. All these aspects, these are also aspects to keep a cordial atmosphere in the court, and to have a good interaction or a good relationship with the community of lawyers and the clients which are dealt who are dealt with in the process of dispensation of justice. Secondly, I said very often there arise conflict in judicial officers themselves to reconcile between the individual personality and the judicial position. While I was speaking to the trainees in the last batch of Munsiff Magistrate training in the Judicial Academy, I told them, whenever you leave your chambers after the court hours, whenever you put your band and collar on the hanger, your gown and coat on the hanger, you should inculcate a feeling, or you should inculcate a conscience in your mind that the moment you get out of the chambers, you become the person and not the judicial officer. I think a little elaboration is required. I spoke to them an example. One day, you had an occasion to travel in a public transport system, in a bus or in a train, usually in a bus. Assume, nowadays it may not happen because even the officers in the lowest rank are being provided with vehicles. But assume a situation that a judicial officer is traveling in a bus, in a public transport bus, which is heavily crowded. I said, probably the traveling public may not recognize you, or there may not be a person who recognizes you, or even the conductor may not be recognizing you. Nobody recognizes you that you are a judicial officer. So because of the crowd, you may not get a seat to sit. There may be personal impacts put onto your body because of the crowding in the bus. You may be pushed from backside. Sometimes the conductor may be scolding you to accommodate others. All these may happen. As we all know, what will happen in a crowded bus if you travel with standing, without a seat, in standing position. So, at that moment, if your conscience start to work out, I am being humiliated, I am a judicial officer, I am a magistrate, I am a subject, or I am a munsif, or I am a district judge, or even a high court judge. So nobody is giving any recognition to me, and people are humiliating me, people are harassing me, people are attacking me. All this, if start thinking, we get sweating, we get our blood pressure pumping up. All this happens. So in such occasions, you should be trained that you are a person. You are just an individual like so many persons traveling in the bus. And it is not your official duty. It is not part of your justice dispensation system or process of judicial system. Such things may happen in many occasions. If you travel in an auto rickshaw, the auto rickshaw driver may ultimately demand you more money than what is actually required. He may confront with you for getting some more amount All this happens in your life. So how to reconcile among the in between your personal aspects and your official duties? How to reconcile between you as a person, individual person, and you as a judicial officer? This task, most of the time, is creating a lot of confusions among the judicial officers. So these are all, I may say, even though actually not conflicts confronting in the exact process of dispensation of justice, these are all factors which contribute to your mannerism, your career as a judicial officer. And most of the time, these type of conflicts will develop into other situations. We had an occasion when an officer, while driving a car, was intercepted by a police officer. Unfortunately, the police officer intercepted, the judicial officer was asked to get out of the car, and unfortunately he was little drunk at that time. So probably on such occasions, if you tackle it in a what you call in a meaningful or sensible manner, you could manage things. Instead, if you start confronting with the police officer, what will be the ultimate situation? This happened factually in one of our judicial subordinate judicial officer with respect to one of them. These are all these conflicts. I am not elaborating upon that aspects or that case. So among the conflicts to be handled, this is one of the major aspects which the judicial officers. Another aspect is the aloofment theory, social aloofment. How far the judicial officers are required to keep aloofment from the society? Are they supposed to keep a total aloofment or disconnection with the entire society, including their relatives, including their nearbys, including their friends? These are also part of the conflicts, individual conflicts, are very often confronted with the judicial officers. Of course, in subordinate judiciary, there is a code of conduct for the judicial officers, which prohibits so many things. But that doesn't mean that you are totally segregated from the community as a whole, including your relatives, your nearby kith and kin, your friends, etc. But you should be able to keep a relationship, cordial relationship, cordial interaction, in a manner not affecting your judicial career or not affecting your process of dispensation of justice in any manner. This also is one of the aspects where a lot of conflicts arises. Probably, as I said, the earlier example of traveling in a bus, if you go to a social function, probably the person who is conducting that function or your friend or your relative may recognize you. He may be busy with other activities. At that moment, probably you may not be recognized in the crowd as a person who is a judicial officer. So those are also situations where some sort of conflicts may arise. How to tackle those situations? These are all very important aspects which the judicial officers has to be given clear-cut understanding and to be given some sort of guidance and practice which will enable a smooth relationship between the lawyers community and the judicial officer, between the society and the judicial officers, etc. Like that, there may be occasions where so many persons are coming across you while you are officiating as a judicial officer for different aspects. Probably there may be occasions where somebody is coming to you because of his previous acquaintance to discuss a matter which is sub judice or about a matter which is pending before your court, about a litigation which is pending before your court. That man may be doing it purposefully in very rare occasions, or that man may be doing it innocently without a proper understanding of the process and procedure because of his ignorance. Both situations may be there, but how to tackle with such situations? See, left to me personally, I am a person who was having a lot of social acquaintance before I became a judicial officer. I was involved in a lot of social activities, including political activities. I may frankly confess that I never kept absolute or total aloofment from the social community as a whole. I still, when I officiating as a judicial officer, I still had a good relationship with so many persons who are my colleagues in the social activities. I may frankly say that there was hardly no occasion that anybody in the social sector, even political or other organizations, attempted to misutilize that relationship in an attempt to interfere with the dispensation of justice in my court. But there are instances where persons, laymen, who may be our distant relatives or who may be related to some of the persons whom we know, all such persons, there are solitary instances where certain innocent people came with a complaint that such and such cases, that I wanted to highlight what exactly is the position. How to tackle with those situations? Of course, if you take it in a very serious manner, it can be brought to an extent where we have to take action, legal action against such person, and all those aspects we can do. But it can be dealt with in a more diplomatic manner also. From my experience in such occasions, what I used to do is, whenever he start mentioning about something which is related to a case, I will immediately interfere and I will put a question to him. Are you intending to discuss something related to a case which is pending before me? If he answer in the positive, I will definitely say, if you are permitted to discuss this issue with me, I will not hear your case. I will not hear the case. I will avoid the case. And what you are attempting to do is an illegality or a crime or an offense. If such an answer is given, most of the persons then and there will stop the matter, and they may not be having any hatred or ill feeling they will say I came because of my my ignorance in the matter. Sorry. I will also say, sorry, you need not mention about the case. There ends the chapter, entire chapter. These are all some of the matters where judicial officers can avoid lot of confronting conflicts in the process of a justice dispensation system. Of course, more mingling with the social activities is prohibited. In the constitutional appointees, just like judges of High Court and Supreme Court, are given more liberal freedom in such matters. But as far as the subordinate judiciary is concerned, there is a clear code of conduct which prohibits social activities. As far as High Court judges are concerned, it is normally we follow the Bangalore Code of Conduct, which is not actually a codified or enacted this thing, but it is a code of self-made code of conduct. But I may say that in that respect also, now the judicial system is transgressing into more unconventional areas by the event of by the enactment of or by the constitutional amendment and incorporation of Article 39A, and by enactment of the legal service authorities, the Legal Services Act, and creation of legal services authorities, the judicial system is more involving in what we call unconventional methodology in dispensation of justice, or in ensuring that justice is ensured, guaranteed to all the citizens of the country without any discrimination on the aspect of finance, communal, sectoral, linguistic, and other matters. So in that respect, a lot of social mingling will become inevitable while involving in this para-judicial activities or legal services activities, which includes ADR methods also, alternative dispute resolution methods also. In those aspects also, you should keep a balance. Being a judicial officer, while involving such activities, you should put, you should create your own Lakshman Rekha. You should create your own boundaries, where within which you can act positively in promoting such legal services, and you should be aware that you should not transgress the limit, going into the public at large or to the society at large in a manner unbecoming of your judicial position. These are also conflicting areas where the judiciary has to take a very keen and confirmed attitude. Then the third one, as I said, how to keep the good morals, good values, and good ethics in the process of dispensation of legal system. In that respect, how a judicial officer can control inculcation of an immorality, propagation of an non-integral practice, perpetration of an unethical practice, how to deal with all those situations. It is also one of the difficult tasks the judicial officers are always confronting with. In order to promote these values, in the process of dispensation of justice, you should always keep a balance. You should always keep a balance with the community of lawyers or the lawyers who are conducting cases before each courts. The litigant public also, you should keep a vigil that how an unethical or a non-integral attitude has to be dealt with. In this respect also, a tactful deal in those matters, wherever there are strict actions has to be taken, that has to be taken. And wherever such attitudes can be prevented at the beginning itself, the judicial officers should make an attempt to curtail such situations, to prevent such situations, and to go ahead with the litigation in a proper proper and better manner, that all the morals, values, and ethics is prevailed in the matter of dispensation of justice. Now, till now, I was explaining about the attitude which has to be taken from the side of judicial officers. But the attitude of the lawyers' community also is of utmost importance in this respect for reducing the conflicts, confronting in the process of dispensation of justice. The contributions from the side of lawyers' community is highly inevitable. Contribution means the proper judicial and affable approach and attitude from the lawyers' community is totally inevitable. In that respect, we often say that there occurs deteriorations in upkeeping those values among the lawyers' community. Very often, we sympathize about the deterioration in quality of the profession of lawyers. Most often it is said that it is because of the enormous increase in the number of lawyers that this happens in an increasing pace. But we cannot find excuse that the increase in quantity can give way to the decrease in quality. We should bear in mind that our judicial system, the judicial system in our country, stand unique because of the uniqueness of our constitution. Our constitution is supposed to be unique because it is even now supposed to be the highest democratic constitution, where democracy is given full extent in ruling the country and in controlling the judicial activities or in the judicial system. The Constitution ensures or guarantees justice on an equal basis. The judicial system, which is one of the most important pillars of the Constitution, is intended to ensure that justice is guaranteed to every citizens of this country. The entire citizenry is protected by virtue of the Constitution, that absolute justice is guaranteed to each one of them. So the endeavor of the judicial system in the country is continuing, I may say. In that continuing process, the ultimate aim is to ensure that absolute justice is guaranteed to the poorest of the poor, to the downtrodden of the or the marginalized of the society, those who are in the lowest strata of the society. I may also say that this is one of the countries where the judicial system is considered at high esteem by the citizenry of this country, those who are part of the judicial system, is considered with utmost nobility, majesty, with high respect and esteem by the people at large. Maybe it has got its own reasons, which partly belongs to the history of our freedom struggle. Because as all of you know, the freedom struggle was led by great stalwarts from the legal fraternity. And those stalwarts in the legal fraternity had risen to the occasion when the social call came, which is for the freedom of the country. And they undertook that social commitment by realizing their social obligations. So that is how a better pedestal in the mind of the society or the people at large is created with respect to those who are part of the judicial system, whether that be a judicial officer, whether that be a lawyer, or whether that be even an educate clerk, or whether that be a court staff. The entire people involved in the process of dispensation of justice is being considered with a high respect, majesty and nobility. Probably you may, at least some of you may be having a different opinion that nowadays that nobility or respect is not there. Probably that may be correct. It will be slowly deteriorating. But what the most important aspect is, what it indicates. It indicates that those who are part of the system has got a greater social obligation. Those who become part of the system, including the lawyer community, should realize that you are a person who is different from the normal people in the other strata of the society, that you should always keep a social conscience, a social awareness, and you are destined to serve the people, the citizenry, with that social awareness in order to discharge the social obligations and in order to fulfill the social commitments. This is what a lawyer requires basically. Unless this conscience is there in the mind of a lawyer cannot grow to the expectation of the judicial system or cannot contribute anything to the society which was mandated by virtue of the provisions contained in the Constitution. If one who is acquainted or associated with the judicial system keep this basic feeling in his mind, basic conscience in his mind, the morality, the values, the discipline, the decorum, the etiquettes, everything follows with that. If you take it as a mere avocation for earning your livelihood, everything will collapse. Everything will turn into a very very, very pathetic situation, I may say. Most of the events concerned with the conflicting morality, ethics, values happens because the lawyers community is getting deteriorated in keeping this basic conscience of a social obligation, social awareness, and social commitment. So the system, if it wants to be revamped, or if the system actually sincerely aim at keeping those aspects or those values, those nobility, those majesty and discipline in the dispensation of justice, or in upkeeping the ultimate aims of the judicial system, should promote inculcating these basic aspects in the lawyer community. Coming to the practical side, there are a lot of aspects. Right from the junior lawyership under a senior lawyer, imbibing what should be, what are all the morals, etiquettes, values to be adhered in the profession, how to behave in the courtrooms, how to behave with fellow lawyers, how to behave with the senior colleagues in the profession, how to behave with a judicial officer, how to address arguments before a court of law. All these are matters which has to be imbibed from the profession itself. And nowadays, in most of the cases, lengthy juniorship under a learned senior, sometimes it's being felt among the juniors as totally unnecessary, unwarranted like that. These are all situations creating. A few days back, while I was discussing with one of my colleague, one of the sitting judges in the High Court, I said, all the advancements utilizing the scientific developments in the process of dispensation of justice is quite admirable. Introduction of the e-filing system is really a good step ahead in the matter of the dispensation of justice. Making available the judgments online to be downloaded by the client or the advocate is a great step which will advance the dispensation of justice, the system more speedy and efficient. All those advancements utilizing the scientific developments in the information technology area has to be promoted, has to be applauded. But I said to my colleague, I am totally against continuing this video conferencing argument on a permanent basis. This I said from the bottom of my heart, because the process of dispensation of justice from a courtroom has got its own significance. Why the morals, values, ethics, discipline, decorum, everything is kept intact is because of so many physical aspects contained in a courtroom. The dais in front of the lawyer, the long armchair where the judicial officer sit in the robes, the court full of lawyers sitting beside you, very eminent senior persons appearing against you, a lawyer who is whom you supposed to be very eminent personality, or even a lawyer who are quite junior to you, the robes you wear, the way in which you address the court, the mannerism you follow while addressing the cases, all this has got its own significance, if I may say, left to me personally. Probably some others may be having a different opinion, but I am adhering to the school of thought in that respect, that the argument of the cases should always be on foot in the courtroom itself. Otherwise, there will be eventually happening deteriorations in the process of dispensation of justice. One of my fellow judge in the High Court, after this lockdown, corona lockdown, she shared one experience with me. While she was hearing bail application online in video conferencing, suddenly the picture of a person appeared in the screen. From the face, she recognized that he is a lawyer, familiar to her. But she doesn't know the name of that particular lawyer. He suddenly appeared in the screen. He was wearing only a lungi, not even a banyan or a shirt. This happened in our High Court. Suddenly she asked to the public prosecutor, "Who is that? Who is that?" And on hearing this, the person switched off his video. Probably the lawyer who was watching the court process in this Zoom on the belief that his video is switched off might have accidentally touched the screen or something like that. Somehow he could. But this is only a funny example, I said. It's an indication of a funny thing. But this is an indication to what will happen tomorrow. If you start arguing a case from your house, sitting in front of a mobile phone or a tab or a laptop, you don't have any feeling in your mind. Eventually, probably the elder generation of lawyers may able to keep such feeling even if you argue a case from your house. But what about the new generation which start practice? They don't have a feeling. They don't inculcate a feeling in their mind that you are arguing a case before a court of law in a courtroom. And you have to be courteous to the court. You have to be disciplined. You have to be polite to the opposite side. You have to be more polite to the judge. All those aspects will vanish from the process of dispensation of system, which will eventually deteriorate the values, the morals, the ethics, and even it will conflict with the proper dispensation of system. So what I may say is that it is for the lawyers community to more concentrate on these aspects, how to recoup, I may say, because everybody accepts that there is deterioration. How to recoup the good old traditions, how to recoup the good old practice, keeping good majesty, good nobility, good discipline, good decorum, good courtesy, in good court manners, etc., etc. This has to be given more and more emphasis, and concerted attempts has to be there to promote all these aspects. If the lawyers community themselves take this difficult task, the deterioration will continue, and the deteriorations will eventually confront more and more conflicts in the process of dispensation of justice. So it is at most necessitated to bring back the good old practice in the lawyers community for upholding the majesty, nobility, and etiquettes in the profession. I may conclude by saying that if the dispensation of judicial process gets deteriorated in its quality, integrity, morality, etc., what will be the ultimate result? That also should be borne in mind by those who are part of the judicial system, including the judicial officers, lawyers, etc., etc. Because as I said, the system is intended to protect the citizenry with absolute justice ensured to each one of them. If the society feels that justice cannot be ensured through this system, they will lose faith or confidence in the system. And ultimately, that will lead to anarchy. The people in the society may resort to other illegal methods, the so-called mafias, Gundaism, and other unethical or illegal anarchy methods in the society. That may lead to a breakdown of the rule of law in the country. But while expecting such a situation, or while just imagining such a situation, who is the loser or sufferer in the first instance? This is an important aspect. The first round sufferer or loser will only be those who are part of the judicial system, which includes lawyers' community also. Unless the system prevails, unless the system cannot command respect or confidence of the society, it is the system which is going to collapse, and it is the profession in which you are involved is going to collapse. It is your bread and butter which will be denied at the first instance itself. So the existence of the system means the system should exist with the utmost confidence commanded from the society at large, is inevitable for existence of each individual who are associated with the system. This is a matter which need to be kept aware in the mind of all those who are part of the judicial system and part of the process of dispensation of justice. And this alone can bring back the so-called deterioration set right to its original majesty, nobility, morals, values, etc. I hope I had shared a few open thoughts in the field of judicial system and dispensation of justice. I thank each one of you for patiently hearing me, and I think this is a dialogue or multilogue which has to be done, and it may not be taken as a monologue. I invite all sort of interaction from each one of you on these subjects. Thank you very much. Thank you once again.
Justice Abdul Rahim, sir, it was wonderful to hear your thoughts, controversial to a certain extent, which may also may be debatable to a certain
extent. Definitely.
That's for sir. The topic today was justice dispensation confronting conflicts. Any system, sir, unless and until there are conflicts and challenges, that will not improve. So it is not the existence of conflicts or challenges, but how to face it and how we deal with it makes the sea change. Beautifully dealt with by the dealt with the subject, though general in nature, but we'll take it one aspect, sir. I mean, for there are around 9-10 questions which are propped up in the chat. If I can put it into one, if I can just summarize into one question before we request eminent Justice Ramkumar sir or Justice MSR Muthi sir to comment. I just wanted to put that question, sir. You were the acting Chief Justice. You were the senior most judge of our High Court. Sir, two conflicting things. Justice delayed is justice denied. Likewise, justice hurried is justice buried. When we have a system wherein the subordinate judiciary is asked to perform on a the question itself, I'd say, sir, whether the introduction of the mark or point system for lower subordinate judicial officers has any impact on the dispensation of justice. If I can borrow those words, when you say that it is not the quality but the quantity which matters, does it directly revolt against what we are standing for, sir?
May I have a little more explanation on what you are intended?
Sir, when we say that it is time bound that you will have to have such a, the first issue we may not be able to debate because whether experience, prudence, etc. can be gauged because the Honorable Supreme Court has said that directly you can have them inducted as judicial officers. We'll leave it as such. But thereafter, when the state apex body also says that it has to be disposed of within a particular time frame or you should have such and such disposals by the end of a month, is it not extra burden on an even otherwise overstrained setup?
Yes. Should I need to answer it right now, sir, or?
We are only on the conflict, sir. Is there any manner in which that conflict, is there anything that the lawyer community or anyone else could play a proactive role so that that could be eased?
Yes.
That
is yes. The yes. Yes. That has come. I don't think that tackling the conflicts confronting in the process of dispensation of justice in a better manner will in any way reduce your volume of output. It's not correct to say that if you deal with the situations in a better manner, in an amicable manner, or in a reconciling manner, it will reduce your output. It is an utopian theory. It will not reduce your output. Rather, it will only increase your output. So, dealing with conflicts has nothing to do with the volume of output which a judicial officer can undertake. Of course, as you said, targets are given. Point system is introduced. These are all measures to make ensure that the judicial officers work in a better manner or in a give hard work to achieve the achieve better output, number of disposals, etc., etc. But that doesn't mean that you should be denying proper opportunities to the lawyers. You should be curtailing the arguments, or you should be always hostile to the lawyers community, or it is nothing of that sort. Of course, administratively, those are aspects which are insisted, because as you said, everybody knows that there is huge pendency of litigation in our judicial system, especially as far as our state is concerned. It is on a high rate because of the high volume of litigations coming to the court, and it has got its own reasons because of the high literacy of the state, etc. And how to mitigate this pendency is a big question, which is always confronted with those who are heading the system. But I may say that it is to a great extent, the reasons are attributable against the executive or the government. Because as we all know, the judge people ratio in our country is very, very poor when compared with other, even when compared with other developing countries. Maybe one of the reasons is our high density of population also. But sometimes we may feel, as judicial officers, we have felt the government or the executive is giving only least preference to provide adequate infrastructure facilities, adequate number of courts, adequate number of judges, and adequate other facilities in the process of judicial system, in promoting the process dispensation of judicial system. All these aspects, when contributing to the increase in the pendency of litigations, it doesn't mean that you should act in a manner which will curtail the opportunities to the litigant or to the lawyer community and dispose of cases in a haphazard manner. It doesn't mean that. So while dealing with the conflicts, I don't think that the heavy work or the heavy pendency has nothing to do with that.
Sir, we have Sharad from Hyderabad with a question. Sharad.
Yes.
Greetings to you, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, we have, of course, the case, the sister,
voice is breaking.
Yeah.
You may kindly put it in writing.
Sharad,
I'll do that. I'll type it. Yeah.
Okay. Wonderful. Now we have Nawaz Jan with a question. Nawaz, please.
Yes, sir. Good evening, my lordship.
Good evening.
Your lordship has beautifully described the stark realities prevailing in the bench and bar. Now, I am emboldened by your frankness to put across a question. It is regarding the conflict caused by the media reports while you consider the criminal cases. Basically, the sensationalism is caused by the media. The media decides whether the FIR is to be lodged. Media decides whether the accused will be granted bail or not. Media decides when will he be given to police custody and all those things. And second question is it correct or is it proper, is there judicial propriety in discussing the subjudiced matter in an evening talk show in the media? These are the two questions, my lord.
Uncomfortable questions or uncomfortable answers, okay.
I don't think that anybody will disagree with me that the sensitization of cases by the media is exceeding all its reasonable limits. I don't think that there may be any dispute with respect to that proposition. But ultimately, it is for the legislature to think about bringing some sort of regulations, which is inevitable and needed, I may say. Because as you said, ultimately a judicial officer is a human being. Whatever we speak on the podium, ultimately a judicial officer is a human being. He will definitely be influenced at least to a little extent by this type of sensitization, by this type of media discussions, etc. It is a menace, I may say, which always conflict in the proper dispensation of justice. But of course, there are instances where cases where courts, at least constitutional courts, have prohibited in publishing anything about any particular case. There are instances prohibiting the media from publishing anything about the case. But such a practice cannot be followed widely, especially when a matter is pending before the subordinate courts in the trial court. The trial court may not have such constitutional power to prohibit the media from publicizing or sensitizing the issues like that. That's why I said it is high time for the legislature to think upon to bringing some regulations with respect to reporting of sub judice matters, discussing about sub judice matters in medias, etc. Personally, I am of the view that it is for the legislature to take up this matter seriously and to bring some sort of remedial measures.
Sir, would you agree, sir?
Thank you.
There is another aspect also. For example, Jessica Lal murder case and yes, some matters which would have gone just under the carpet. It was the media which took. I mean, I'm not talking about litigants or matters which are pending, but media did play a proactive role in bringing forth.
Exactly. That is the role of media. That is the duty of the media. But once such things which are kept under carpet is unearthed and bring to the notice of the investigating machinery or to the court of law, there ends the role of the media. Then it has to be dealt with in a judicious manner by the court of law in the judicial system, in the process of dispensation of system. There, in that system, in that process, how could the media can be permitted to be involved? That is the real question.
Absolutely. Sir,
there some sort of regulation has to be introduced. That is my personal view.
Correct, sir. Sir, we have Radhakrishna Murthy, who is also from Hyderabad. Radhakrishna Murthy, you have a question?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, sure.
Yes.
Yeah. I may be permitted to share my views in respect of this judiciary system and all. Earlier, actually, that there was a 3 year term, that is minimum practice, to eligible for a junior civil judges. But subsequently, you know, the Supreme Court judgment and all, even the fresher also, that they can, appear for that exam. So the whole difficulty is actually after the examination, they are not finding time because of the paucity of the judges and all, straight away that they are coming onto the bench. Because of that and all, actually, they are not aware of any of the proceedings, first thing. Apart from that, since they have not practiced and all, they are not aware of the precept, all those things and all. So we are finding lot of difficulty in that. One thing. And second thing, as far as the judges, that is judges appointment to the higher category, that is High Court, whereas and all, actually the one who has very good practice and all, that kind of advocate, that they are not elevating to the bench at all. So basically, actually, you know who is like, who has the power, only those guys are, it is happening and all. Therefore, necessarily that they have to bring lot of changes in that system while appointing the lower category or in the higher category. That's what my view.
Your statement is well taken. I don't think it requires any answering because it's not.
Yes.
But Radhakrishnamurthy, your statement is taken well. We have Sharath's put it. Sir, why I... Of late, the quality of selection of judges has suddenly fallen. Is it because the institution is being controlled by executive? That also, sir, I leave to you to answer.
it's an area of controversy. Each legal person may have his own opinion. But of course, one thing probably everybody will accept commonly, that the quality of selection process sanctity and quality is not being kept in such utmost honesty or integrity as it was done in earlier days. This quality in the selection process, somewhere some aberrations are happening. This is a factual matter which everybody has to consider. But whether the system of selection need a altogether change, how the influence of the government machinery can be controlled, all these are highly debatable issues with respect to which everybody will be having his own views. So it's a fact that the quality should be ensured. Quality in the matter of selection has to be ensured. It's a matter which need open, wide thinking, open discussions, etc., etc. And this three-year issue, as said earlier, now it is heard that the Bar Council of India is taking up the matter before the Supreme Court in a review petition. Probably we can expect that something may turn around in future. Because as I said in the earlier, it may not be fully correct that they are unaware of the procedure, because 1 year training gives them awareness about the procedure. They are academically brilliant, they are given good training, they are given good knowledge about the procedural law also. But that by itself doesn't suffice the situation to handle or tackle the process of actual dispensation of justice in the courtroom. There is the issue. As I said, if one keeps in mind that the community of lawyers are those who are intruding unnecessarily into the dispensation of justice system, if that is the basic feeling one keeps in his mind, how far he could be a good judge? This is the situation. That is how all the confrontations, misbehavior, I may say, or demining the status of the lawyer, justice and comments, all this happens. Equally, vice versa, also from the lawyer community, also it is happening. But somehow these are all matters where more conflicts are created. Yes.
Sir, one more. If you, sir, the issue of recusal. Why should a judge recuse himself, sir? Because when the judge takes an oath, without fear or favor, I'll discharge my duties. I understand if his nearest family member or somebody appears, he can recuse. I understand. But otherwise, why? Of late, this is happening a lot nowadays. What are your comment on that, sir?
Unfortunately, for avoiding a case by a judge, the judge is not supposed to reveal the reason. So we don't know why the increasing tendency of refusing or avoiding a case happens. But as I said, as an individual person, if he is capable of reconciling the conflict between the individual and the judicial officers, I think the conflicting areas can be minimized, or the conflicts can be minimized. And if one could practice or able to reconcile those conflicts, he need not avoid so many cases or anything like that. That is what I feel.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sir, we have got PK Dinesh Kumar Kalpeta. Dinesh, unmute yourself, please. Yeah, please. Dinesh, you are not audible.
Now, am I audible?
Absolutely, you can. Go ahead, please.
Sir, may I ask a question, sir?
Yes.
It's in fact not a question. It's a thought in my mind. After hearing you, and after experience as a lawyer for last 27 years, in my mind, it really occurred that is there any pro if what will be the impact if a proper system for appreciation of both bar and bench is introduced based on the performance base in our system? Is there any barrier to introduce such a system? It should be applicable to both bar and bench. It should be also purely based on the performance base. What's your comment on that, sir?
Yeah, for what purpose such a appreciation you are intending?
Appreciation of in quality, absolute quality. Quality alone, nothing more. Not on the number, appreciation in quality of the performance.
No, in what manner you are proposing to recognize such appreciation? That is what my question. Now, if a judge feels that a so-and-so lawyer is very good, very good, how he will acknowledge that? That is the question. Merely because that lawyer is very good, the judge cannot allow a poor case filed by that lawyer. So, in what manner you are intending that this appreciation should reflect?
Performance of an advocate or a judge cannot be measured in a single instance.
Definitely. Definitely.
If such a measure is introduced, what will be the impact on our system?
No, of course, among judicial officers, such appreciation is there. Because when a judicial officer is promoted from one particular cadre to other particular cadre, evaluation of his judgments is being done in the High Court. In certain cadre for promotion, separate interview is conducted, and only those who are qualified will be given promotion. Only those who are whose judgments are ranked above the mark is given promotion. All these aspects are being considered. Like that, for allowing continued service after attaining the age of 52, 56, and 58, evaluation is being done. And only if the High Court afford a sanction for their continued service, they will be permitted to continue. In certain cases, they will be found unfit and will be removed from service. Such instances are also there. Of course, such an evaluation and appreciation for quality is being done among the judicial officers. But what about the lawyers' community? Even as I put the question, if a judicial officer feels that this particular lawyer is very good,
that also
he can keep that attitude in the mind. But how that can be reciprocated or that can be reflected?
Sir, if you would permit me, I would just add that it is for the client
yes.
to decide which lawyer to engage.
Yes.
You decide to engage X, Y, or Z. That's my take on that, sir.
Yes, sir.
Nazir Mohidum. Nazir, are you there? Sir, before I come to Prema, may I request Justice Ramkumar to have his comments on
that? Yes, yes. I expect a lot of a lot.
No, I don't intend to speak much. See, on the question of media sensitization, etc., there is already a judgment of the Supreme Court in Dr. Anand's case, where the Supreme Court clearly observed or directed all chief justices to take care of the situation where there are media excesses or there is a trial by media which is of such a magnitude that it derails the trial before the court. Chief Justice should intervene and issue appropriate directions. Which Chief Justice does that? Nobody does that. There is a direction in that. In fact, I had penned an article on trial by media. It was in the Nuals Law College where media persons and law students attended. The college also promised that they will publish my article. The article was not published by the college. None of the media persons also published my article because it was mainly against them. And law students, of course, they some of them imbibed the subject, that's all. See, what about this Kodathai case? What about this alleged uxoricide by the man using snakes? Snakes. All these things are in the news channels. It is being done. News channels. It is being done. And we get in the local news channels at about 10:30. We find certain news items called Kuttapatram crime story, etc. Where once an FIR is filed against a person for rape or murder or whatever it be, that person is shown as the most despicable person in the world. What about the presumption of innocence? Is it applicable to courts only? And is not the media bound by the presumption of innocence? He is to be presumed to be innocent until he is found guilty by the court of competent jurisdiction. What is happening in our country? And by the time, and take the case of that Kodathai case or even this uxoricide using snakes. Supposing that case ultimately comes up before court and court passes an order of acquittal for want of legal evidence. legal evidence. Even motives will be attributed to the judge. Motives will be attributed to the judge.
Definitely.
What is happening in our country?
Brother Ram. Yes.
Yes.
Sorry. One question, sir.
Yes.
Now, this High Court is in order to mitigate the litigations, there was a proposal to establish a High Court in the Trivandrum. Then why the High Court is opposing that, the setting up of a High Court over there, in Trivandrum, sir?
See, first of all, the matter has been decided on the judicial side. It has become final. Nobody has taken it up to the Supreme Court. Number one. Number two, does a state like Kerala require such a circuit bench? Small state like Kerala. And in fact, one argument, I was the law secretary, one vociferous argument raised to us that crores of money is being spent by many of the officers, and including secretaries, coming to Ernakulam, having discussion with the AG. And having discussion with the GPs for preparing counterfeit, etc. I made a humble suggestion. Why not post two government leaders in the secretariat, government secretariat, for preparing counterfeits? That was opposed by the then Advocate General. Why should the government spend crores of money for IAS officers and secretaries to go over to Ernakulam and have discussion? And many of them I know, they don't come to Ernakulam for having discussion with the AG. Or the government leader, they come here for other private. In the meanwhile, they also meet the GP or AG, as the case may be. So, anyway, do we require such a circuit bench? Is a question. Anyway, that's not for me to answer. But now, on the media, this is my view. In fact, the chief justice should they interfere? Should they? That is the direction of the Supreme Court. A very beautiful judgment in Dr. Anand's case, which I had occasion to refer to in my article on trial by media.
Now, brother, I may ask one thing.
Yes.
You were acting in different capacities. You were a trial judge, a sessions judge for quite a long time, and thereafter law secretary, and thereafter high court judge for some considerable period.
Yes.
Have you come across any instance anywhere in the country where by virtue of this particular judgment, whether any sessions judge had reported or requested the chief justice concerned?
Not necessary. No judge should request or report. It is for the chief justice to take suo motu action.
Suo motu.
Yes.
Is there any instance?
There's a direction by the Supreme Court.
Yes.
What about this Kodathai case? What about that Sariza case. All those cases, media was. And what about that Dilip?
Dilip so many cases.
They have convicted, virtually convicted the so-called accused. What remains is only the passing of sentence by the court. And will a judge decide against the media? Media
correct. As you said, the presumption of innocence has
putting great pressure on the judiciary.
Correct. But then, I have never come across any instance where any of the High Court Chief Justices passed any order on this.
Nobody does that. Despite the direction by who, it is a direction, not mere observation. Yes. And then, of course, they can unearth materials which the police are unable to get at, either due to corruption or due to other means. They can certainly bring out materials and either help the police or even help the court. Correct. But not conduct a parallel trial and prejudicing the mind of the viewers throughout the world.
Definitely.
Then on the question of senior advocates and elevation of judges, I personally feel that the High Court, once senior advocates are appointed or judges are suggested for elevation, the High Court should not have a feeling that a better hand was omitted. That should be the attitude, according to me. The High Court should not, High Court or the judges, the collegium or whatever it be, they should not have a feeling that we omitted to recommend a better hand who continues in the judicial, in the legal profession, either as a senior advocate or as a judge. That should be the attitude, so that you go by quality, the merit and capability. Merit and if once that is adhered to, I don't think there should be any reason for any such things. And
one doubt, sir.
Yes. Yes.
Pradeep, unmute yourself.
A lot of pending cases are there in the High Court. Why can't a bench can be started in Trivandrum or elsewhere? And the High Court is opposing that. It is quite there for a long time. It is pending. What is the why the High Court is opposing the setting up a bench in the Trivandrum or Calicut or somewhere, sir, so that the litigation, so that the pending cases can be come to a minimum.
That is not for this forum or this platform to discuss and decide. Let us leave it to the High Court. And it has been concluded on the judicial side. It is, nobody has attempted to rake it up by filing an appeal before the Supreme Court also. There is a decision by Justice Balasubramaniam on dealing with all aspects of the matter. Right or wrong, it has not been questioned in the Supreme Court. Then on the recusals, I personally feel that why not a judge who is recusing from a case give his reasons? It may be good, bad or ugly, but that may be, there can be an understanding that his reasons will not be justiciable and it will not be discussed in public. But he can certainly, for example, there are very, very many rightful recusals where the judge might have appeared for one of the parties or one of the groups ventilating a particular cause, etc. There are valid reasons. Why not reveal that? And very often the public thinks, was the judge approached? Why is he recusing? Was he approached? In very many cases, there is not a case of judge being approached by somebody. There may be valid reasons for recusal. Why leave it for the public to have...
Now,
doubts
in that matter, I agree that quite often the judge may be able to mention the reasons for recusal.
Yes.
As you said, maybe the client is known to him. Maybe the earlier round of litigation he has given advice or he has appeared for any of the parties like that. But there are instances where it is better not to mention reasons also.
But then,
for the sake of, maybe there, very few instances.
So
I am of the opinion that the judge should be given that discretion, whether to reveal the reason or not.
Option. He can be given the option, and there can be a decision on the judicial side that the whatever reason the, disclosed by the judge shall not be subject matter of any public discussion.
Shall not be justiciable,
so that the matter should die out there, then and there.
Absolutely.
Then erosion in standards are there at every level, not only at the low subordinate judiciary,
every level.
Supreme Court, even the highest office of the Chief Justice was under criticism, fire. So let us not go into those things. I personally feel that there should be our system. I only say a system, whether it be the lawyer community or the judges community. Our system requires frequent refurbishing for regaining its pristine glory. Every of now and then it should require a refurbishing, both and. Erring judges and erring lawyers are there and have been there and will be there. So, no, you can't have a panacea for that. And bias and prejudices, all those things. There are judges with bias, prejudices, etc. There have been, there will be also. It is something to some extent subjective. We know, we as lawyers, we know that some cases we know which judge to be approached on the judicial side. Which case, and we know there were pro landlord judges, pro tenant judges, pro kudiyadupukaran judges. We all know the psychology of the judges. The bar is the best judge to evaluate the psychology of every judge. So nothing like that. Therefore, that prejudices, bias, etc. will always be there. It has been there. Will be there also. Then let us not subject the subordinate judiciary alone on the question of the subordinate, the new raw entrant or fresher from the law college entering the judiciary. We of course they will be wanting in realizing the difficulties of a lawyer, but who is responsible? Supreme Court alone is responsible. We have to blame the Supreme Court only. Even Justice Shetty Commission recommendation was that they should have bar experience, but it was not given. If it was not heeded to by the Supreme Court, so remedy lies only in the Supreme Court. Only in the Supreme Court. These are all my observations.
Thank you very much, sir. Justice M.S.R. Murthy, sir, are you there?
Sir, I'm happy to be a part of this webinar. I enjoyed this session. I would like to share my humble thoughts on three aspects, sir, provided the time permits. The justice administration institution of justice is one caption we can give, which encompasses all the players. It has a code of conduct, which we can call it as a genus. In this genus, there are species. See, different codes of conduct for different players or participants, namely code of conduct for judges, code of conduct for lawyers, code of conduct for staff, code of conduct for advocates who are representing the government and the state and the institutions, code of conduct for the parties, code of conduct for the witnesses, code of conduct for the other institutions which are associated, like forensic laboratories, police, and other things, code of conduct for the visitors, and so on. Broadly, most of the rules of this code of conduct are common for all, though some are unique, like for judges, a kind of social curtailment to some extent is required. For advocates, they are court officers. Like that, there are some variations in this code of conduct. Most of these rules are unwritten. Some are true, they are written, but these unwritten rules are been observed since a long time. So they became the code either by practice or by observance. If every participant of the institution keeps within the bounds of the code of conduct, which is by now very well known, then there is no problem whatsoever. Everything goes smoothly. So this is very important. See, whether we call it ethics or code of conduct or values, see, they cannot be taught, in my humble view. They have to be picked up right from the childhood while growing up. Values are never taught, they are inculcated by observance by the elders and people around in the society. And if this is done as in the past, I don't think the next generation, we can complain, is not having values, because we will be inculcating values to the next generation and the generation next and so on. And most important thing is, for a judge or a lawyer or a staff member, everybody must be learned. They need not be highly learned, but they must be adequately learned. And this learning gives always confidence to do the required work. And along with the learning and confidence comes the humility. When one is humble, in my humble view, mean nothing which is undeserving or unwanted happens in a courtroom situation or in a court premises, for that matter. So this kind of inculcating values, in having people with required learning and adequate common sense to discharge their duties, is very, very important in the system. And coming to the quality and quantitative disposal, my humble view is, if the bar is a qualitative bar with well-informed lawyers, most of them at least, and the judge is equally learned, adequately learned, and has the required qualities, he gives a confidence to the bar, here is a judge. He is capable of delivering qualitative judgments, and automatically his court becomes a ready court. Even the oldest matter, which is pending on the file since a long time for various reasons, will be reported ready. And for the judge, there is no requirement of counting the numbers at the end of the day or at the end of the quarter or half year. Automatically, everybody reports ready, because the judge is a qualitative judge who can deliver. And therefore, he gets at the end of the day more than the required units, double the quota, triple the quota. So this is very, very important. So everything is associated with the code of conduct and also the adequate learning coupled with common sense. And above all, for a judge, what is required is equanimity. If these qualities are there, I think the court can be called a model court. A model court, in my humble view, is one court where the judge is model judge, because a convicted accused or a losing litigant walks out of the court hall with a feeling that they are fairly dealt with in the system.
Justice has been done.
That fairness is very, very important. Then comes the last thing. A judge has to hear courteously, give an impression to the bar and the litigants that he conducts his court wisely, and the judgment must reflect that what has been submitted, what is involved, is considered soberly, and the decision is ultimately rendered impartially, having regard to the rule of law and also the oath that is administered, true to the oath that is administered. So these are very, very important aspects which I think the institution has to concentrate to see that it maintains the glory and achieves, in fact, if I may say so, the old glory.
Thank you very much, Muthi sir. Before we wind up, Prem, over to you.
Justice Chidambarish has gone.
He has just left 15 minutes ago. I just... 1 second, sir. Yes, sir. He has just left 15 minutes ago.
Okay.
Please,
well, Rahim, sir, it was really a wonderful talk. But I have two things to say. First thing, let me just begin with the question of recusal, which of course was dealt with by Justice Ramkumar. Now, sir, I have the occasion to hear the speech of Justice Nariman over on a YouTube channel. Of course, this particular recusal, it was never dealt with. But anyway, there's two instances were pointed out. One was in a case which was handled by an American Chief Justice called Chief Justice John Marshall of the United States Supreme Court. That is in Marbury versus Madison, where Marbury's appointment order itself was an order which was written and signed by the Chief Justice himself while he was a state secretary. And Marbury comes before Chief Justice Marshall. He never recused. That's the first aspect. Second one was of Lord Mansfield in the famous Gordon Riot case, which we popularly know as the Black Wednesday case also. Gordon Riot, Lord Mansfield's bungalow also was burnt out. And subsequently, Mansfield was a person who had acquitted Gordon. He never recused from trial, even though he was a personal sufferer. So my humble view is that except in very, very personal, if you have very, very personal things to say, then only recusal need be resorted to. Now, let me just put a question to you, sir. With your permission, okay, sir. Now, the thing is that it does have a bearing on the subject which we are dealing with. Nowadays, we used to see write-ups of some judicial officers. I'm not taking any names. Now, those judicial officers, they are writing on Facebook posts, ever so many social media posts, even against the judges of the High Court and the Supreme Court. Should not be such methods be checkmated, especially when such aberrant officials, they treat the lawyers too with great intolerance when we are in the courts. And if such officers are not properly dealt with by the higher echelons, automatically judiciary, which is considered to be the most strongest pillar of democracy, not only the lawyers, but the public at large, who view all these comments on the social media, they ultimately lose faith and confidence in judiciary. And would not that be a doomsday for the entire democracy? That's a question which vexes my mind.
Can I answer?
Definitely, sir.
Regarding the recusal, I perfectly agree with what you said. At least in exceptional cases where there are extreme reasons, a judge need not recuse from hearing a case. That is the common thinking, and that is what is required commonly. But there is another aspect in that which is also need to be considered. Suppose the client, the person involved in the litigation, had a feeling that I may not get justice before this particular judge because of obvious reasons. See, justice should be done and should be made to be done.
We believe in appearances.
Yes, appear to be done. In such cases, whether it is right or wrong on the part of the judge to think that if I deal with this particular case, the litigant on one side may have an apprehension that he may not get justice. In such case, whether the judge is justified in recusal of a case, that's also one aspect to be dealt with. Then the second aspect, already the High Court has initiated disciplinary action against one judge with respect to this writing in the Facebook. And that particular judge is now facing charge with two different charges with respect to similar occasion.
and he is facing disciplinary action. I also perfectly agree that there should be some sort of a restrainment from the side of judicial officers in publicizing matters which are controversial. Of course, the
institutional discipline.
Yes,
should always be there.
Should always be there.
But it sends wrong, erroneous signals to the society at large.
Correct.
And there
One more thing.
No lawyer should be allowed to get in touch on the WhatsApp or Facebook to a judicial officer, because I know of situations where some lawyers send messages. Oh, sir, that Your Honor, that was a great order, great, wonderful order. We know the purpose of such messages. They should be banned. Lawyers should be banned, and judicial officers also should be banned from having. That doesn't mean that they are not part of two sides of the same coin. Two sides of the same coin means they will not see each other.
But sir, in England, the principle is that the judges they can mingle with the silks, that's the designated seniors, not with the other.
There, the boys. Things are very different. Things are very different. The attitudes are different.
Correct.
I may say that if both sides are matured enough, there is nothing wrong. But we don't know whether anybody is mentally matured or not. that is the problem.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for the
more issues are thrown open than answered. That is the very important purpose of these deliberations. More food for thought. So, sir, that brings us to the end of the 46th session. Tomorrow we have one of the senior advocates, one of the youngest designated senior advocates of Supreme Court, Aishwarya Bhatti. She will be dealing with paradigm shifts in constitutional interpretation. Tomorrow, 3:30. Sir,
Welcome. See, Pandora will commit suicide after this lecture.
Anyway, it's a very good exercise during the time of lockdown.
Yes,
instead of merely idling in houses. If you,
sir, could, you are now cut out for webinar lectures.
Sir, it was an inspiring lecture, sir.
Thank you, Advocate. Thank you very much. So, thank you, Justice Abdul Rahim, sir, for agreeing to address us to be part of this platform, which is an ongoing.
No, I don't. I am quite afraid whether instead of delivering a legal lecture, I delivered an open speech like that. Quite upright.
We want to view things in different angles. We want to have a feel of an issue, a matter from different perspectives. It was in fact an eye-opener for us.
Yes.
We are indeed thankful to you. We are thankful to Justice Ramkumar sir, Chidambaram sir, MSR Murthy sir.
Thank you, everyone
of you for being part of this journey. Till we meet again tomorrow, 3:30, please take care and stay safe. Thank you.